It is again a great honor and opportunity for me to stand before you, and I pray to God that He pours His Holy Spirit over me, a humble servant, so that I can bring this Word of God, which is so vast, so amazing, so beautiful, so powerful, before you. Amen. Shine like a star. Shine like a star. That's the title of my message tonight. Whenever you hear this phrase in 2019, shine like a star, I think there are at least two things that might be going on through your mind. One thing you might think immediately here, especially living in LA, the Hollywood stars, right? Famous people. The papers and the magazines all over the world write about them. And a lot of people would like to be like these stars, or they would like to be a star one day. Or if they can't, at least copy them, and they want to know everything about their lives. But if we take a closer look, we see that, you know, it's not that beautiful as it shines. Those stars, they don't shine as beautiful as it seems. They have a few problems, right? Family problems. They spend a lot of time in courtrooms, suing one another. Once in a while, when I go to the register to pay in the store, I just see again a magazine, a star beaten up again. They have big problems, you know, addiction. Some of them, or a lot of them, commit suicide. It was pretty sad when I heard about Whitney Houston, such a great voice, drug overdoses. Pretty sad. Not really the role models of our lives, right? Then there is another type of stars, the stars in the sky. Now, for you guys who grew up in LA, I know when you look up to the sky, you see those lights, those are airplanes. I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about actual stars. I'm just kidding, I know you know what stars are. But one thing needs to be said though, I'm glad that Abraham didn't live in LA when God made him his promise, I'm gonna make your offspring like the stars, looking up to the sky, counting up to 20. Lord, that's it, 20, it's gonna be my offspring. Yeah, shine like the stars. Let's open up our Bibles, or Bible apps, to Philippians chapter 2, second part of 15, first part of 16. There is a beautiful sentence in there, and we want to look at this sentence tonight. Philippians chapter 2, second part of 15, first part of 16. You must shine among them like stars lighting up the sky. I'm reading from Good News Translation, by the way. Most of my verses tonight are going to be from Good News Translation. So, you must shine among them like stars lighting up the sky as you offer them the message of life. And let me repeat it one more time. You must shine among them, among the corrupt and sinful people, like stars lighting up the sky, as you offer them the message of life. Amen? So, the first thing we want to look at tonight is the first word. You must shine. So what does your identity need to be so you can shine? But let me start with a much easier question. And let me ask you the following. Who are you? An easy question, right? My daughter Alice, 2 years old, can answer it. But it's also a pretty hard question. See people walking through this life at 30, 40 years, sometimes even older, and they're like, how could I do that? Who am I? Seems like they still didn't got their identity. Now, this question brings along another three questions. This question of identity brings another three questions. First, how do you like to identify yourself? How do you like to identify yourself? When you think about yourself, what do you think is your identity? Do you like to identify yourself with a job, with your job? Do you like to identify yourself with your relatives? Do you like to identify yourself with your achievements? Do you like to identify yourself as the victim, the person who always complains, never something works for him, he's just sad, everything works bad? Or do you want to identify yourself with your religion? How do you identify yourself? Two, how do other people identify you? And let's just stick with the family, because they know you the best. When they talk about you to other people, what's the main thing about you? What's the core thing about you? How do they identify you? Three, how does God identify you? And we want to spend a little more time on this. Let's open up our Bibles to Job. Job chapter 1, verse 1. We're going to see something very, very interesting here. There was a man named Job living in the land of Uz. So we have his name and we have his address. And now let's see what the scripture says about him here. Who worshiped God and was faithful to him. He was a good man, careful not to do anything evil. That's one. Two, he had 7 sons and 3 daughters, family. Three, and owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, and 1,000 head of cattle, and 500 donkeys. He also had a large number of servants and was the richest man in the East. Whoa, 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 what did you just say? Richest man in the East? Why isn't that on the front page? Why isn't that right at the beginning? There is a different type of order. But it gets even more interesting in verse 8. When God has this conversation with the devil about Job. And listen what God says. Did you notice my servant Job? The Lord asked. There is no one on earth as faithful and good as he is. He worships me and is careful not to do anything evil. Dot. Finish. That's it. But God, what about the fact that he's the richest man? What about... No. Did you see Job? He's faithful. No one on earth as faithful and good as he is. What does God say about you? Now, don't get me wrong. Please don't get me wrong. It is great that you have a good job. It is great that you have money and that you achieved a lot in your life. I'm really glad when I see Christians that achieved a lot and that have money. You know why? Because Christians should know the best what they should do with their money. That's why I would like the richest people to be Christians. That's good. That's good, guys. Everything's fine, you know? It's fine that you have great relatives, you know, it doesn't matter if it's Trump or whoever. But what is important is what God says about you. And what is important, we're going to find in John chapter 1, verse 12. And listen to that. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children of God. The right to become children of God. You are a child of God. You, brother and sister, are a child of God. I mean, what greater identity is there on this earth than this? that the creator of this universe is your God and your Father, and that you are His son and daughter. There is nothing better than this, guys. And you know, I don't know when I'm gonna pass away from this world, but one thing I keep thinking about, a little early maybe, is one day when I pass out and when I go away from this world, one thing I want to be remembered is my relationship with God. You know, I'm happy if in this life I could provide a lot for my kids. It would be great. But one thing I want my kids to say about me is, you know, the thing about my dad is, you know, he always liked to pray, to sing songs. He always talked to me about God. That's what I wish for. Let's move on. The second thing, the second point, is the second word. You must shine. You must shine. Must. Not the most beloved word in 2019, right? But let's be honest, it never was. Never was, I think, at least. But one word that is very much emphasized in the churches tonight, in the society nowadays, is the word freedom, right? And freedom is great. I mean, it's one of the core truths about us as Christians. We are free through the blood of Jesus Christ, amen? But what we do with this freedom, that's what troubles me just a little, what we do. And therefore, let us learn something tonight from somebody in the Bible. And you might not expect that I'm going to say this title, what he had, or, you know. It's the Pharaoh of Egypt. Yes, I said Pharaoh of Egypt, not John, Peter, or Paul. Pharaoh. Genesis chapter 41, verse 38. Before we get to that, Pharaoh had two dreams. Very disturbing. He wakes up and he tells his magicians, his wise men, guys, I had two very disturbing dreams, and I want you guys to tell me what it means. No one was able. Then his chief cupbearer, it just made click in his mind, and suddenly he remembered Joseph. He goes to Pharaoh, and he's like, you know, that time when you got me in prison with the chief baker, well, you know, there was actually a guy, you know, we both had dreams, and there was actually a guy named Joseph. He told us what it means, and it truly happened that way. So maybe we should give it a shot, kind of. So they called Joseph. Joseph arrived. Pharaoh tells him the dreams. Joseph, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells him what it means. The fact that a famine was about to come to the land, and the Lord wanted to prepare the Pharaoh so he can do something about it. And although he was not asked, Joseph, as a wise and smart guy, attaches an advice to this whole interpretation. And there we are, 38. And he tells the Pharaoh what he should do. Pharaoh, you should select a smart guy, a wise man, to rule over this country. And then he gives him all that advice. And now we are at 38. So Pharaoh asks his officials, can we find anyone else like this man, so obviously filled with the Spirit of God? Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has revealed the meaning of the dreams to you, clearly no one else is as intelligent or wise as you are. You will be in charge of my court, and all my people will take orders from you. Only I, sitting on my throne, will have a rank higher than yours. Pharaoh said to Joseph, I hereby put you in charge of the entire land of Egypt. Now, what we want to learn tonight from this guy, from Pharaoh is the following thing. He was smart enough to understand something. Joseph is filled with the Holy Spirit. And he didn't send him back to his cell and said, thank you for your interpretation and for your advice. He said, you are the wisest man because you could tell me what these dreams mean. So you're gonna be in charge. Now, what do I want to say with that? Since Jesus was the only one able to free us from sin, from eternal damnation, from the chains of darkness, since He's the one who created us, shouldn't Jesus be the one to rule over our life? What better thing is there for us Christian than placing the freedom we got through Him at His feet and say, Jesus, You are my Creator. You are my Savior. You are my Lord. I don't want to rule over my life. Because I'm not as smart as You are. I'm not as good as You are. I can't do it, Lord. I want You to do it. I want to follow You, Jesus. This is what it means to be poor in spirit. To know that you can't do anything without God. And in everything you do, you totally depend on Jesus Christ, on God. Amen? The path of God is a path of obedience. A path of a servant who in everything what he does wants Jesus to be glorified. Jesus to be glorified. That's, I think, what made Paul such a great servant. Because Paul understood, you know, that whenever he had to heal somebody, he healed him for the glory of God. Whenever he had to cast out demons, he cast out demons for the glory of God. He wants Jesus to rule over his life, and he listened to His voice. And when Jesus said, now I want you to proclaim the gospel and to preach the gospel, and Paul preached the gospel. That's what I think made Moses such a great leader. Because he lived in such close proximity to God. He always wanted to be close to God, to see His face, to hear what He says. And when you live so close with God, when you have such a strong relationship with God, when God truly rules over your life and you give Him your freedom, you give Him all who you are, your whole being, what greater thing is there on earth than that? If people are healed in this place, then it is for the glory of God. When we pray, it is for the glory of God. When we worship, it's for the glory of God. And when revival comes to this church, it is for the glory of God. So that this church knows that there is a God who has power. So that Anaheim knows that there is a God who has power. So that LA knows that there is a God who has power. Amen. Hallelujah. There is a God who has power to heal, to save, to set free. Do you believe that tonight? Sorry, I got a little loud there. Okay, let's move on. 3. How are we able to shine? How are we able to shine? Now, it's not going to be only the third word. It's going to be the rest of the whole sentence. So it's not going to be too long tonight, right? Okay. You must shine among them like stars lighting up the sky as you offer them the message of life. as you offer them the message of life. The way we shine, the way we shine like stars in this darkness, is through proclaiming the message of life, who is what? A religion? Set of rules? No. Jesus Christ. Amen? Who is, I'm asking this question again tonight, who is the center of the scripture? It's Jesus. Amen? Who is the center of God's kingdom? It's Jesus. Why do you want to go to heaven? Because of Jesus. Amen? When you look up to the sky, let's learn some things from the stars. When you look up to the sky and you see those stars in the desert or in the mountain, where do you see those stars assembled? Do you see them on the left side of the sky, or do you see them on the, it's the right, or to the right side of the sky, or in the middle? Where do you see those stars assembled? Because when I look up to the sky, I see stars all over the place. Matthew 5, 14 to 16. You are like light for the world, for the whole world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a bowl. Between which four walls do you see the stars when you look up to the sky? Listen, guys, we cannot come with our lamp, shine, and then as we get out, cover it really nice. Now come back and shine again next Sunday, cover it. That's not possible. We are, our house is on the hill, and it's nice to have a house on the hill. I just rent a house on the hill, and it's amazing. Our house, spiritual house, of course, needs to shine so that the whole world sees us. Amen? When you look up to the sky, just imagine there would be no electricity on Earth, and you would see only one star. Wouldn't it be quite sad, quite dark? All this darkness, and then you see a little star. It would be pretty sad. He told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest to do what? I know you are a few, but ask the Lord God to make you more efficient so you can bridge the gap. Is this what the word says? No, it's not. Listen, guys. The light in you is very powerful because it comes from God. But you are limited. You can't do the work of God alone. You need other people around you. That's why unity is so important. All the stars in the sky were created with the same purpose. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest field. Let's ask the Lord to send out workers. More workers. We want to be more workers. That's a project, right? I hope and I pray that this church is full with people so that all of us can be workers for the kingdom of God. But until then, let's start with as many as we are, especially the ones at night, because you make the extra effort to come at night as well. I like that. May God bless you for that. Then the third thing. The third thing I really like about stars is that they keep shining. It doesn't matter if it rains. It doesn't matter if whatever happens. They always keep shining. They're there. Keep shining. And they're not like Christmas lights, you know? Christmas lights are great, but Christmas lights always wait for their season. And then when they light from 5 p.m. to 11 p.m. and they shut off, right? And then they are so special. They just shine and they make so many tricks and colors, blue, red, green, Stars are different. They just shine. Well, we don't need to be like Christmas lights. Just hear Christmas and Easter and then shine in a special way with a special song. And no. We need to shine all the time. Persistence. That's what God wants. Persistence. Keep on doing the good work. So let us not become tired of doing good. For if we do not give up, what happens? If we do not give up, then time will come when we will reap the harvest. We will reap the harvest, guys. Don't give up. But shine. Keep on shining. And we will reap the harvest. Do you believe that? Persistence. Don't give up. Keep on shining. And then, the last thing. I'm going to close a little earlier tonight. Stars are a part of a constellation, or if you want, of a galaxy. Stars are a part of a galaxy. This church is a hospital for the sick, for the sinful. This church is a hospital for those who need to be lifted up. This church is a hospital, amen? Now, when I was in Austria, I worked for a while for a medical company. And when I got there after a while, I was asking my supervisor, "Sir, you're working now for this company for a really long time. You know all the hospitals here, around here. Now please tell me, you have the insight. To which hospital do I need to go? Which one is the best? Tell me the best hospital." And listen to the answer. He said, "Well, it's not that easy. Look, I mean, if you have a problem with your heart, then you need to go to this hospital. If you have a problem with your brain and you need brain surgery, then you need to go to that hospital. If you have problems with your bones, then you need to go to that hospital. If you have that problem, you need to go to that hospital. And if you have the other problem, you need to go to that hospital." Now, what I want to ask you tonight is, what kind of hospital is this? What kind of hospital is this? Don't get me wrong, I just said, all the stars are supposed to shine. They were all created for the same purpose, but they are all part of one galaxy. What hospital is this? We can't run in 10 directions, guys. We need to specialize on something. And that's all I want to say to that. And I want to close with an example of a person, a little story. And this person is amazing. Is amazing. I want to tell you something about a person who truly shined in this world. I want to tell you something about Elizabeth of Hungary. Elizabeth of Hungary. She lived quite a time ago, 800 years ago. She was the daughter of Andrew II. Andrew II was the king of Hungary, so she was a princess. Now, as it was custom at that time, she got married very early, at the age of already 14 years. So 14 years, she got married to Louis IV of Thuringia. So she moved to Wartburg, I'm just going to pronounce it in German, castle. And Wartburg Castle is very known to us, or at least to some of us, because it was the castle where Martin Luther hid for 1 year, about 300 years later, just as a fact. Now, she moved to that castle, and whenever her husband was out of town, she clothed herself in very decent and normal clothing, not to look in any way special, and went on the streets and provided food and clothing for those people, and whatever else they needed. When her husband came back, she went back and clothed as a princess. And when he was gone, she went back to the streets because she didn't want to upset her husband. Now, in 1226, there came a devastating famine to the land, and her husband was gone. So she took a very, very important decision on her own. She opened the castle's granaries to provide food for those in need. Now, the bureaucrats, they were very angry with her decision, and they're like, you don't know what you're doing. Anyway, Louis IV heard about the famine, and he rushed home. When he got home, the bureaucrats are going to him and say, man, I don't know what's going on with your wife, and she just opened the castle's granaries. She gave food to all those people. But he's like, no, that's fine. I support her. And together, they fed 900 people a day. 900 people a day. They helped their whole community, their whole kingdom. But 1 year later, Louis died. And his brother Henry became king. And Henry was a bad guy. And in the middle of the winter, he sends this princess on the streets with her three children. She tries to find refuge, but no one. The very people she helped, the very people she fed, the very people she gave clothing, they didn't want to let her in because they were afraid of the king. So she slept in a stable. 3 days later, she found refuge in one chapel what she built with her husband. She lost her wealth. She lost her status. But although sometimes she even had to beg for money so that she has food for her and for her children, she still gave part of that to the poor. She did everything she could to help those in need. Now, her father, Andrew, heard one day about what happened to his daughter, and he was angry. He was angry. So he was even ready to do war against this guy, Henry. And he sent one of his highest level ambassadors to go get his daughter and get back to the land. His ambassador arrived in Thuringia, and when he saw Elizabeth, he started crying. He started crying, and he went to her and kneeled down before her and said, Princess Elizabeth, your father sent me to get you home. What they did to you is not right. You're a princess. I want to get you home to your father. But you know what she said? No. God has called me to do his ministry here. I will stay here. Because, and listen to that, I am serving a greater king than my father. Let us shine like stars. Amen.